Well, hello. Welcome to the Cincy Library Film Club. My name is Ben Lathrop. I'm from the Information and Reference Department of the main library. With me is my co-host, Ann Driscoll.
Hi, I'm Hello.
In addition to being part of my team at the library, Ann's an accomplished artist, performer, composer. She even created the theme song for our film club. Ann's also been part of the Mini Micro Cinema and recently put together an excellent article on all the great offerings available on the Canopy streaming service provided by the library. If you haven't seen this, you want to check out our blog. It's blog.cincinnatilibrary.org. Long before I was a librarian, I studied and taught film history at Ohio University, and I worked on the Athens International Film and Video Festival. Movies have continued to play a huge part of my life, and since becoming a librarian, I've been looking for an opportunity to run sort of a book club, but for movies, and it turns out that opportunity is right now. So we'll be hosting a title from the great selection of films that we have available to stream for free with your library card, announcing it a few days in advance, and then meeting back here on Facebook Live to discuss it.
So for our first film, we went with a recommendation from our special guest, actor, playwright, and educator Kevin Crowley, who will be joining us in conversation about Bo Burnham's remarkable debut, Eighth Grade. Kevin is an actor of stage and screen. His film roles have included pivotal supporting parts in the Todd Haynes films Dark Waters and Carol, as well as other locally shot movies Donnybrook and Goat. Earlier film credits include The Fugitive, Backdraft, and comedy classics Major League 1 and 2. A veteran of the stage, he is an alumnus of Chicago's Second City Improv Troupe. And as a playwright, he won the Audience Award at the Cincy Fringe Festival last year for his musical, The Vegetables. Kevin teaches drama at the School for Creative and Performing Arts in Over the Rhine and has a bunch of parts in upcoming films in post-production. Before we invite Kevin to talk about Eighth Grade, let's take a look at a scene from one of his films, the contemporary classic drama Carol, which many critics included on their best of the decade list. Full disclosure, it is one of my favorite films of the 2010s. This scene features Cate Blanchett as the title character and Kevin as her lawyer, Fred, who has to be the bearer of very bad news regarding a nasty legal battle in which Carol's estranged husband is weaponizing Carol's relationships with other women in order to prevent her from seeing their daughter. Please roll clip.
Can I see her?
Let me put it this way. It wouldn't be advisable
at
under
school?
The...
school? In an office?
The issue is not where, necessarily.
Surely a visit.
Carol, these are serious allegations. Forcing contact before the hearing, you risk inviting further scrutiny concerning your conduct.
My conduct? Jesus Christ. I'm a mother, for God's sake.
Kevin, welcome. Thank you so much for being here.
Well, thanks for having me. Nice to see everybody virtually.
Good to see you.
Well, Kevin, before we discuss the movie, we were hoping to talk with you a little about your career and your background. You've been involved in many of the major film projects that have been made in town recently. And as a Cincinnati native, we were just curious about what was your experience like shooting these films so close to home?
I returned here in 2006 from Los Angeles primarily because of the advent and popularity of reality television. It just took so much of the work away, and I wanted some place to raise my children. And I really thought I was leaving that life behind. And then Cincinnati became sort of this hotspot for filmmaking. And, you know, with my credits and experience, I became a valued commodity, unlike what I was often in LA and certainly in the film world. I did a lot of sitcoms because of my Second City background, some 1 hour stuff, but if I was in films in LA, it was security guard number two. But, I was getting offered really, really nice meaty parts, and it was thrilling. And so I thought I'd left that part behind. And so it was really nice to be able to do so here.
Kevin, so you recently participated in the Monologues for Hope series.
Oh, right.
That was put together by the Playhouse in the Park folks. And I was just wondering if you could talk about that project and how you got involved and what your contribution was.
They hired 10 local writers, and to write these monologues of hope to give people something to look forward to provide some content at a time when everybody's sequestered at home. And Blake Robeson, who's the artistic director at the Playhouse, reached out to me to be an actor in one of those pieces. So the piece that I performed was actually written by a local playwright, Joe McDonough. And it was kind of a fun challenge. One of the things that I really wanted to do, they've posted several of them, and most of them do a direct address to camera. And I wanted to do something a little bit different and appear to be talking to somebody off camera. And because of the setting of my apartment, I also get great late sunlight. And so I shot it over the course of three or four different evenings, hoping to find this like kind of perfect lighting and shadow. And I was really pleased with the version that I came up with. So, and I guess it's been viewed, as you pointed out, Anne, like 10,000 times. So that's really thrilling.
So your entry to last year's Cincy Fringe Festival, The Vegetables, it's a pretty idiosyncratic musical.
Right.
It deals with some heavy themes, but also has a lot of humor. It won the Audience Award. How would you describe that play? And, you know, do you have any other works in the pipeline for upcoming musicals or theater projects?
I had never done a musical, which was kind of appealing to me. And my friend Tatum wrote the songs for it. But I had been going back and forth between here and Los Angeles the last couple of years before I got the job at SCPA. And I have a very close friend who had a brain aneurysm and is in a vegetative state. And he was in a facility in Los Angeles. There was nothing but patients like him, which was very surreal. These people are living kind of in this netherworld between life and death. And I would spend time with him to give his wife and daughter a chance to go get a meal or a shower. And I started thinking about, you know, what this facility was like and hosting these people and their families and their stories. And so I came up with these sort of four interconnected stories where people were in a vegetative state and their families come to visit them. But then the vegetables, as they're called, could get up. And because I wanted to imagine that they could sing and dance again. I wanted that for them. And it is, as you pointed out, it was very idiosyncratic. And I had had back surgery the day before we opened and I was in it. So it was crazy. And I had a seventh grade kid and I had two 70-year-olds in it. It should have been an abject failure and it somehow came together so well. And it was just a really beautiful experience. And I was really pleased with the reaction.
Yeah, the staging was really interesting with sort of the rotating stage. It was very dynamic.
Well, that set piece was built by a kid at SCPA who was a junior in high school. And for $200, he basically built a turntable. I mean, we were able to put four adult bodies on interconnected hospital beds and you could push it with one finger. And that was an engineering feat by a junior in high school. So I was fortunate again to have the job there. But, you know, that school is a pretty special place and those kids are pretty extraordinary.
In lieu of bringing the Incredible Hulk into a classroom to engage kids, how has it been going with keeping your students engaged during this time?
Well, I mean, the whole thing with him, first of all, Mark Ruffalo is probably the world's nicest guy, and I'm probably not the first person to point that out, but there was a day where he had the day off from the shoot and had generously offered to come into the room, and so we invited juniors and seniors into the black box down there, and he just sat and answered questions. And his assistant had said, you know, at 12, he was in pre-production for this HBO show that just came out where he plays twins. He's got to be out the door at 12:30. And so 12:30 rolls around and I said, sorry, kids, that's it. He's got to go. We got to get him out of here. And he pops up and he says, hey, how about I take selfies with everybody? And so for 45 minutes, he stands there and takes a selfie. And then I start noticing like third graders are coming in and janitors are coming in. I'm like, no, this has got to end. He's probably the most famous person, but because of my years as a professional actor, I've managed to bring in, I had a friend who was directing, who lives in Chicago, who was directing a show at Shakespeare 12th Night last year. My friend Austin Tishner came in. I've brought in a Mexican drag performer who does like these Shakespeare famous Shakespeare characters, but he'll do Juliet as Miley Cyrus, but in Spanish. I mean, it's so wow. I'm able to bring in people that I've met or know if they're in town. This when Second City was performing at the Playhouse, they came down and did some workshops. So I'm really able to tap into sort of, you know, 35 plus years of professional experience to get my kids an introduction to all kinds of different facets. So I'm really lucky.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
So I really am curious to know more about your thoughts on eighth grade.
Yeah.
You recommended this film originally. And before we actually just get into the discussion, I'm just going to introduce it. Eighth grade is about a very shy, very awkward 13-year-old girl named Kayla. She lives with her doting single dad, makes YouTube videos that basically nobody watches, and hopes that the greener pastures of high school await her on the other side of middle school graduation. The film deals with topics like social anxiety and technology as Kayla seeks to make sense of herself and her peers while immersed in the worlds of Instagram and YouTube. Eighth grade received universal acclaim upon its release, especially for its then 27-year-old writer-director, Bo Burnham, who before this film was known primarily as a stand-up comedian and YouTube star. Elsie Fisher, who plays Kayla, also received overwhelming praise. She earned a Golden Globe nomination for Best Actress. So let's watch the trailer.
Hey guys, it's Kayla back with another video. So, the topic of today's video is being yourself. Being yourself can be hard, and it's like, aren't I always being myself? And yeah, for sure. But being yourself is like not changing yourself to impress someone else. A lot of people like call me quiet or shy or whatever, but I'm not quiet.
Most quiet, Kayla Day.
I don't talk a lot at school, but if people talk to me and stuff, they'd find out that I'm like, really funny and cool and talkative.
By the way, I like your shirt a lot. It's like so cool. What?
Kayla, one more week of eighth grade, huh?
Huh?
I said one more week of eighth grade, right?
Yeah.
That's crazy.
Yeah, huh?
Okay, so growing up can be a little bit scary and weird.
We will begin to explore these changing bodies of yours. It's gonna be lit.
Don't hold back, I wanna break free.
As always, make sure to share and subscribe to my channel, Gucci.
I think you're so cool. Maybe you just need to put yourself out there a little.
I'm gonna stop eating with you if you keep doing this.
You said I could say one thing.
I'm really, like, nervous all the time. I try really hard not to feel that way. But you just need to face your fears and let people know they're really you.
Just grab my phone, how to charge it.
Yeah, I mean, sometimes I charge it too. But my phone, I...
Just because things are happening right now doesn't mean they're always gonna happen.
Who was in there?
Just sort of my hopes and dreams.
Right.
I was a complete mess when I was your age.
Really?
Eighth grade is the worst.
You never know what's next. And that's what makes things exciting and scary and fun.
When did you get Snapchat? What grade?
Fifth grade.
Fifth grade?
Jesus.
What? Yo, see?
All right. So, Kevin, what was it about this film that really connected with you the first time you saw it?
The first time I saw it, the thing I connected with mostly was as a parent. I raised two boys, and it was just really, really insightful. I really wondered about this generation and how social media had impacted them. And soon after seeing it, ironically enough, I became an eighth grade teacher. And sort of was plunged into that world. And it's true. I mean, I don't know. I have this pet theory. I mean, it's probably not groundbreaking, but this idea that everything these kids do and that they put on social media is judged. You either get the thumbs up or the thumbs down or the hearts or you don't get hearts. And that's what's so heartbreaking about Kayla in this movie is, you know, she, as you pointed out, she puts this this vlog up there and nobody watches it. Three people. I think her dad is the only person. And also, just as an actor, the man who plays her father is so wonderful. And he just is so earnest and he loves her so much. And there's nothing he can do that's right, as is the case with most eighth graders. I had seen it, I think, on my own. And then my son was back in town, so I took him to see it. And then soon afterwards became an eighth grade teacher. But, you know, Bo Burnham was somebody that my kids would watch with his goofy YouTube videos when they were little. And it was only after seeing the movie that my son, who I took to see eighth grade, introduced me to his two Netflix specials, which if you haven't seen them, are really revelatory. I mean, he's the heir apparent to Steve Martin. His stuff is so smart. He's a talented musician. He is really, really, and I have a high bar for comedy, but his stuff is really, really, really terrific.
Yeah, it's a pretty remarkable debut for somebody at that age. And he's been yep. putting out intelligent, insightful comedy since age like 17. I mean, right. He's been on the scene for a long time.
Well, it's funny. I've been doing a lot of, you know, Google Meet. Now that I can't be in the classroom with my kids. And I said, look, this is, you know, you've been training to be a stage actor. That's out the window. It's going to be a long time, maybe a year or more, before 150 people are willing to gather in the dark and watch a stage play. Now you're going to learn to be a film actor. And we have, what we teach on is a Schoology program, and it has a platform called WeVideo that's an amazingly user-friendly, accessible editing system. And so I'm encouraging them to make these videos. They'll do monologues, or I'll give them assignments. The other day I gave them an assignment where they are the world's worst supervillain. They are COVID-19. And it's that point in the movie where the supervillain has the superhero tied up and they do their big monologue, what, here's why I'm going to destroy the world, or here's why I'm so evil. And they've been coming up with some really creative videos. So I said, it's not enough anymore just to hold your phone up and shoot yourself and hand that in. You're going to have to learn how to create and understand how films are made. And clearly, I think since he did this, he self-taught from the time he was 13, 14 years old. And he obviously, by the time at 27, he knew what he was doing behind the camera.
Yeah. You touched on a lot of topics that the film addresses. And I think it's very thematically rich. It's about social anxiety, technology, the relationship between parents and children. And it also, the thing that I always hear from people who've seen it is they say how real it feels. There's mm-hmm. like a certain authenticity to the film. And I'm just really curious, as an actor, how much of that relates to just the performances, to the acting quality? Is that part of what makes eighth grade feel so realistic?
I think he probably set that tone early on. I mean, I think he really wants the viewer to feel like you're eavesdropping on really, really uncomfortable moments in this young girl's life. I think particularly one of the scenes that really stood out to me is, and I think maybe you're going to address this down the road, so I hopefully I'm not leapfrogging, but you had said one of the critics called it the best horror film of the year or something like that. Because it makes you so uncomfortable. And there's a scene where she gets in over her head with an older boy and is in the backseat of a car. And if that was a big Hollywood movie, it would have taken things to an extreme. There would have been, I think they probably would have had a rape scene. He does not do that. He takes it right up to that line and it makes us squirm but he doesn't cross the line. And it's so in keeping with the tone of the rest of the film. And I just think he's got a real auteur's touch. You know, he really is a very accomplished young man.
Burnham has said that, you know, he has people tell him all the time, I'm so glad that scene didn't go where I thought it was going to.
Absolutely.
It was, it's one of the most uncomfortable scenes. Yep. And we can definitely talk about it later, I just wanted to chime in there.
Well, sort of, we're starting to talk a lot about the acting process. And so from somebody with that acting background, but also somebody that's been working with young people, what really stood out to me is Elsie Fisher's performance, just incredible. And especially as she was about 13 years old during this filming.
Yep.
So I wondered if you could maybe just elaborate on what it's like to work with an actor that age, or any insights that you maybe have from watching that performance.
It is interesting working with these kids, and I sometimes have a hard time getting up in front of them, as I was saying earlier, like and saying like this can be a viable career. But with SCPA, and it's on there. You know, one of the things they say is that what they're after is to foster a lifelong love for the arts, and not necessarily. I'm not going to delude you into thinking this is a possible career option. It might be, but for most people, it is not. It's just not. It's a very tough field. As far as her, you know, and working with young kids, it's hard to get them to understand to be real like she is in that movie. Yeah. Their understanding of being on stage is to be big and loud. And so to tone it down and to be just as real as you possibly can is difficult. And I don't think it's an accident that she is slightly overweight. Her teeth are crooked. I think, again, Bo Burnham chose an accomplished young actress, but one who looks like that and who was not afraid or embarrassed to share that with the world, warts and all. Because it's important that we see that. Because
sort of relive those things, yeah.
Yep. Because we're all, pictures of me at 13, you know, would drive Dracula back into the grave. But I mean, all of us, I mean, we're all just, you know, that's just probably the worst time of life. And that he would go there. And again, until I got into the classroom with these kids, that was a world that was very foreign to me. My kids were grown at the point that movie came out. They kind of had access to that world a little bit, but so this social media thing has changed everything. And, you know, I guess we used to get bullied up close and now you're bullied online, which is, you know, probably in many ways much more painful.
Yeah. I definitely think that Elsie Fisher's just her presence alone lends the film authenticity because right. She was on the cusp of graduating from eighth grade.
Mm-hmm.
When the film
and the kid who plays her, you know, the really gawky, the geeky, gawky kid who she meets in the pool, who has the holding breath contest. And mm-hmm. I mean, it's so perfectly cast. And the dad, like I said, is just when he follows her to the mall and is spying on her. It is a horror film. And it's also a comedy in many ways, because good comedy often makes us feel it displays awkward qualities. He obviously understands that. Again, if you watch his Netflix, his stand-up specials, he's really a master at that stuff.
Yeah, it's both a playful film and laugh out loud funny at times, but also exceedingly dark in other
ways. Yeah, cringeworthy, absolutely.
Sometimes at the same time.
Yep.
Right, so Bo Burnham has said that the more you engage the internet, the more ambivalent it becomes. And I think the movie is very sort of even-handed in how it portrays the internet. I don't think it says it's all bad or all good. Doesn't really take cheap shots, but it also explores, you know, some of the problems that can come with it. We're going to show a clip now that visualizes Kayla's escape into the world of her phone, set to Enya's Orinoco Flow, which is one of the key scenes in the film. Please roll clip. Okay, so I'm not sure if that clip played, but we're just going to forge ahead with the discussion of the film's treatment of technology. Actually, one of the reasons why eighth grade, I think, is such a fitting first pick for a virtual film program is because it's about people looking into the cameras on their laptops and sort of talking into a void and trying to connect. So, yeah, just the visual language of the film, of people illuminated by their screens, is sort of apropos for how a lot of us are experiencing life in the quarantine.
Well, you know, and not just that, I think they did a really interesting thing whenever they showed Kayla's YouTube videos, where it's in a very staged environment with the perfect backdrop. She has more makeup on and is sort of performing this version of herself. And you hear that in the dialogue overs, where she's even like, kind of pretending to be the popular girl in the one story she tells about that. And so it's not just, I think, like seeing reflections, but it's also this construction of identity in those spaces.
Yeah, absolutely. And one of the things that struck me the second time watching it that wasn't immediately apparent to me the first time is that when she's praying, there's a scene where she's praying to God and she says that she believes in God. She uses the exact same speech patterns and language that she uses when she's giving her YouTube monologue.
Right.
Yeah.
And so for her, speaking to the internet, speaking to YouTube is sort of a quasi-religious experience where she's trying to reach out and connect to some sort of being, which I found, I have to say, the second time I watched this movie, I found it even more profound and sort of philosophical in that way.
Well, it's funny. I mean, I was rewatching in anticipation of this the other night, and there's the scene where she gets up in the morning and applies a lot of makeup and then plops back in bed, takes a picture of herself and says, "Oh, I just woke up. You know, look at me." I mean, it's so wonderful at capturing how we kind of, and I think a lot of, and I know a lot of adults who do this, who have their online identity, you know, which you would think everybody, their life is just fabulous. Here's this Bloody Mary I'm having while on its flight to Tokyo and things like that. But, you know, I mean, nobody's life is perfect. And we know this in reality, but this is this Facebook, Instagram has given us an opportunity to create an ulterior personality in many ways. And some people dive all the way in and the rest of us maybe just dip our toe a little bit, but we're not always fully there.
Yeah. Well, I think that might be a good segue. You had brought it up already. USA Today is who had this quote where they called Eighth Grade the scariest film of the year. And the scene that you mentioned is the one that came to my mind too. As soon as that older high school friend leaves the car, you can almost hear like the horror music cues, right?
Dun, 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 dun.
That is going to happen. Yeah. But I wonder, you know, I mean, it's generally just kind of a provocative statement. And maybe some of the things we were just talking about with technology and identity would be part of this. I'm just wondering if, you know, seeing a little bit more of what your reaction to how scary this movie is.
Well, you know, I remember leaving it, and I do think I saw it on my own just because I had heard so much buzz about it. And it just really, it was one of those gut punch movies where I kind of had to just go and get a coffee and sit for a while because I just thought, like, you know, are kids really living this duplicitous life? Is that really happening? Again, my kids were out of the house at that point, and this was before I was in the classroom. And are they really suffering, excuse me, from that much anxiety? And unfortunately, now that I've been in the classroom for 2 years, they are. And I don't know why. And it really, you know, and then this pandemic just adds to that because, you know, anxiety is caused by unanswerable questions. And so, I find a lot of my time online with the students is just talking them off the ledge, you know, and really trying to be honest with them. What next fall is going to look like? Because, again, in Ohio, we're talking about, you know, I mean, the University of California just announced that they're not doing fall classes. Everything's going to be online. I don't think anybody knows anything. And every day we're learning more and more, but that just contributes to this anxiety. And that's how I felt leaving that movie, was just anxious for this generation. And how they handle it again, by creating these personas that aren't real. So it's more good.
Yeah, I think what also contributes to that sense of anxiety is the score, which I think is like one of the best scores I've heard in a very long time. I mean, it's like this fantastic but very bizarre, just sort of synth score. It almost reminded me of like Wendy Carlos's Clockwork Orange with these like disturbing arpeggiated synths. And so you feel just the sort of terror, but also the ecstasy and like how those things can just be in flux. The pool party scene I thought was incredibly anxious, rivals Jaws with terrifying water, water experiences in film. And the composer, Anna Meredith, is a Scottish composer, and she actually worked with Bo Burnham. He had developed demos beforehand that she kind of took instruction from. So I think Bo Burnham's background as a musician really, you know, affected how well the music was composed and integrated into the film and conveyed that sort of sense of anxiety and just foreboding.
You know, that's funny. That leapt out of me upon second viewing this time, and maybe it was just because watching it on a computer screen instead of in a theater, and knowing his musical background, that's interesting that he had played laid out tracks for her, sort of suggesting what he wanted. That's very interesting. Yeah, and you're absolutely right. I'm sure that's an homage to Jaws, that pool scene, because that's very cringeworthy. Or the scene where she, you know, and then right after the pool scene, then she gives the popular girl the present. And that girl, again, the casting, that girl is just perfect. Just the faces she makes, it just, you just want to, you know, reach into the screen and smash her.
Well, but then, you know, that was something that really struck me about this. And I'd watch Heathers over the weekend, right?
There you go.
So thinking about that kind of traditional teen drama structure, And the thing that I appreciated here is Kennedy, this popular girl, isn't really made out to be a villain. You know, at worst, she's sort of just, she's aloof. She's not interested. She has her own friends. And if anything, she's kind of as embarrassed about this whole thing that her mom pulls.
Yeah.
By, like, this forced invite. And that felt a lot more, you know, it's sort of bullying through exclusion instead of the really dramatic, you know, typical genre picture to take to high school.
That's a great point, Ben. I mean, I love the way her invite to Kayla, because the mom calls her over and says, you know, come to this party. And Kayla's like, oh, I can't. I think I got something going on. And then Kennedy sends her a text that says, my mom wanted me to invite you to my party. So here's me doing it or something. It's just so passive aggressive.
Yeah.
It is just, yeah.
Yeah, it's rough.
One of the most interesting parts about the pool party scene, and also the scene at the mall, is that we just watch Kayla listening to the conversations that other people are having and trying to sort of be engaged.
Mm-hmm.
And there's so much told just on her countenance.
Yep.
Her anxiety, mm-hmm. and her like attempt to sort of conform without really feeling like she connects or belongs.
Yep.
And I thought that was such a smart observation.
Yeah.
And actually in mid-90s, which is sort of a similar film in a lot of ways that Jonah Hill did, but sort of from a young men's perspective, there's also a scene where the young character is just shown observing other people and sort of trying to assimilate and find his way into that group. So,
yeah, I don't know that there had been a film like that. I mean, we certainly had our, you know, American Pies and all this stuff, and we get raunchy boy movies, and then there comes along, well, Heather's Mean Girls, and there's just mean girl movies. But this is almost a genre unto itself. And I remember thinking at the time, and I think that was the year Moonlight, right, won the Academy Award. There was a whole mess up with whether it was La La Land or Moonlight. And they're both excellent films. But, I mean, for my money, that was the movie of 2018 that I thought eighth grade just – and I recommend it all the time to my students, like especially of that age. You really need to check it out.
Yeah, actually, Anna Silman of New York Magazine said it should be required viewing for middle schoolers, but it is an R-rated film, and it is. So, is it a film for kids? Is it a film for adult? Like, what is the appropriate age range for this movie?
You know, I toyed with showing. I have been showing a lot of content because on Google Meet or Zoom, I'm able to share my screen, and so I've found a lot of short films to show, and the National Theatre of Great Britain has been sharing. Some of the plays that they've shot. Last week was Frankenstein with Benedict Cumberbatch, and it was remarkable. Danny Boyle, who's a film director primarily, had directed it. At one point, there's literally a train that comes out on stage. I mean, the budgets are just remarkable. And Benedict Cumberbatch's performance is one of the most physically mesmerizing things that I've seen. So I am sharing content, and I thought about sharing eighth grade. But I think it there are, you know, I'm not the one to introduce them to some of the things that come up with it. One of the other things that struck me about this movie, and now that I'm steeped in the world of teaching, was this very cavalier approach to these school shootings. There's the scene where the principal walks down the hall going, bang, you're dead, bang, you're dead, bang, you're dead. And Kayla uses one of the drills to go flirt with the boy that she's in love, you know, she's got a crush on. For the kids, this is just... I mean, I'm several generations older than you guys, but, you know, this is their duck and cover. You know, back when in the 60s, when we thought we were going to get hit by Russian nukes, we were all going to go in the hallway and turn into a ball and we'd be okay. And now the first time that I had to go through one of what they call these Alice drills, where I had to sit in the dark with my students and hand out three hole punches that they were going to throw at somebody who had an AR-15. I mean, it's just ludicrous. And we're without getting too political, but again, that's part and parcel of their daily existence. And now mine, that at any point there could be a shooter coming down the hall, and here's the drills that you have to go through with this. And I find that really, really tough to swallow that's what we've done to kids now. So.
Yeah, that scene was very striking.
Yep.
No, it is rough. Well, so we're kind of running on time, but sure, there's sure. a couple things that I wanted to get in. You touched on it a little bit, the father's role in the picture and sort of watching it from the perspective of a parent. I just wondered if there was anything else that you wanted to add about that.
Well, there's not much you can do right. You know, I always tell people that don't have children, that's a shame, because now you'll never know how stupid you are. You know, because your kids will remind you every day just how stupid you are, and they can do it with just an eye roll, and it's devastating. But you know, I mean, especially at that age, I was just reading something about now, like social scientists are starting to get into what happens again at puberty with kids like that, and they're just off the charts. They're just not even in control of themselves. Mm-hmm. But that dad, like that father is so loving. And then I, if I'm not mistaken, we never really know what happened to the mom. Is that correct? I mean, it's kind of nebulous, which is really kind of wonderful. Or is
he
it
says something strange, like after your mom left,
okay.
But implies that she was a baby when it happened.
Okay.
And I kind of wondered, you know, like thinking back on it, like one, having it be a single parent, that's not a woman.
Yep.
Isolates Kayla even more for a lot of this stuff. And so it's kind of necessary to make the story work. The other thing is, as realistic as everything seemed, I feel like any kid is going to have at least one friend. And they made the choice to not do that here just to further, you know, like separate her from everybody else. But yeah, I think they kind of just wave that away, whatever happened to mom, just so that dad can do his thing.
But friend-wise, it does end hopefully, because she does
definitely
establish a relationship with, you know, the other kind of outcast kid.
It has the most adorable date I've seen in a long time.
Yep. No, absolutely, Ben. Yeah, no, it's just so if people are watching this thinking like it's all, you know, dark and you want to get razor blades out afterwards. No, it is. It does end hopefully. And even more so with the you know, they show her, I think, in high school or in the ninth grade where she's born. Because they do what are they called? The time capsules. Yeah.
Yeah, it ends with her recording a message to herself
right
at the end of high school.
Yep.
And she expresses a lot of hope and just optimism.
Yep.
And did you notice that in the memory box, she puts one of the chicken nugget sauces in there from her with Gabe?
Oh.
Yeah. I loved it.
Yeah.
The rainbow array of expert marksman, Gabe. Well, so we've got a question that came in from the live feed.
Okay.
Looks like there's a quick comment. Christina agrees that all the content does happen in middle school. The question, though, is from Dan W., and he asks, how do you think the movie would be different or the same if the movie had taken place 15 years ago? I.e., what's changed or not changed about the hellish middle school experience?
Let's see. Well, 15 years ago, my kids would have been, my oldest son would have been in middle school. I think those social pressures have been around since time immemorial, but it's just that now that so much of it is done. I mean, kids are living online and not necessarily in the here and now. And again, that online presence becomes even more important than who that person is in the hallway or in the classroom. I'm trying to think, you know, 15 years ago, was Facebook around? Instagram, I don't think was. Or if Facebook was, it was certainly in its infancy. But again, younger kids, I don't think really Facebook as much. I don't know, you guys are younger. You could probably address this better than I.
I think the pressure to like narrate your own life on social media has probably increased. 15 years ago, I mean, Facebook was definitely more predominant, I think, among that group than Instagram. It is kind of funny how the characters in eighth grade are like, Facebook's passe.
Yeah.
Well, they even have that conversation explicitly at the mall where the high school kids are talking about how Kayla, like talking to Kayla about her, that her experience is totally different,
right,
generationally right different from them.
Right. And they're 3 years
only
difference.
2 years difference. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, we're kind of, like I said, we're coming up on time. Is there any last thoughts or maybe suggestions of similar titles that either of you want to throw out?
Oh, wow. You know, I was on Canopy today. There's first of all, I just want to advocate that everybody go and check it out. I mean, first of all, it's a phenomenal resource, and a lot of the I was really impressed with a lot of the titles on there. I mean, I don't know that there's really anything like this movie. As I said, I mean, it was kind of a couple genres of the raunchy young boy movies, and then there's mm-hmm. the mean girl ones, and that's what makes this movie so unique and special. I think is it kind of found its sweet spot. And again, in anticipation of doing this, I was looking to see what he, because I'm really, really curious what he's going to do next. I mean, I'm just so impressed with him as a writer and director. I don't think it's on Canopy, but again, if you have Netflix, I would check out his stand-up specials, a couple stand-up specials, because they're not just him on a microphone doing jokes. There's songs, there's bits, and it's really high concept. It's really closer to that Steve Martin performance art than anything I've seen in quite some time.
Yeah, films that I would suggest that might be similar to Eighth Grade are Booksmart, which I don't believe is on Canopy, but has some similarities, I would say. Just in
very
that
funny.
Very funny. Definitely a kinder, gentler portrayal of the young female experience than a lot of the high school movies of yore. Also, Lady Bird is on Canopy, and I think that's a really
Lady Bird. That's a good yes, excellent yes. That's similar in tone to this.
No one feels the closest. I have been reminded of like Welcome to the Dollhouse, which is this much sort of meaner take on the same kind of story. But
yep,
that apparently was an influence on Burnham.
I would assume. Yeah.
That makes sense. Yep.
Well, Kevin, thank you so much.
Thank you guys.
Great recommendation and making the time to join us tonight.
Of course.
And everybody out watching this on Facebook, thank you for joining us as well. Please let us know what you thought in the comments. Like this post, make some comments below. Watch this space for updates on what we're going to have next time. We will hope to be back here next Tuesday, and we'll announce our pick before then, and hopefully be on a better schedule after that. But we hope you enjoyed it. We did. And thanks for hanging in there with our technical stuff and our first one. But thanks a lot. We'll see you next time.
Thank you, guys.